Hi Tejinder, welcome to the Red Sparrow, welcome to Untangle. Today we are going to be untangling all the bits and pieces that go into making Tejinder Singh, both the artist and the person behind the artist.
Thank you Shashi, thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me also.
It's our pleasure. Tell me what's happening in this lockdown. Have you shot anything or
no.
Are you... Yeah.
So, I have actually packed my camera and I've kept it in my trunk ever since. So, I was shooting one of Anurag's film, which is still unannounced. And we got back on 20th March and to Bombay. And since then, I have not taken my camera out. I've been shooting a lot on Polaroids these days. So, a lot of photography on my mobile and a lot of photos on my Polaroid. And what I'm doing is I'm revisiting my old work.
Okay.
And just seeing what I've shot in past 2 years, especially the films. That's how I've been keeping busy mostly. Yeah.
Have you been watching films and reading books also?
Yeah, lots of films. Lots of TV series also, and I'm reading a few books on Punjab these days. I'm also trying to develop my own film script and looking out for stories. There's a lot of work that needs to be done on Punjab and about Punjab. So just reading a few books. There's this book called Punjab. It's by Amardeep Sandhu. So it's always on my bedside. It's a little heavy book also. Yeah. So I'm reading this, and I'm reading this another book called Role of Honor by the same writer. So okay. I go back and forth between the both books. Yes.
So are you also looking at directing the film that you're writing, or just?
Yes. So it's already right now. I'm not really a writer, to be very honest. I don't know how to write, honestly. So what I'm looking at is other books and maybe try and adapt something, from the stories that are already there and the kind of stories that I resonate with personally. But yes, I'm definitely looking at directing something in the future, maybe 4 years from now.
Okay. So Tejinder, we have a certain format with this show. We divide it into three sections.
Right.
So the first section is called Inception. So there we will talk about your childhood and your days at architecture at Chitkara. And then your decision to go and study at IIHS.
Okay.
Then we will move on to the second section called Assembly Line. So
there
we will talk about your learnings at IIHS and how you trained yourself to become a photographer. And then we'll go into the third section called Harvest. So there, that is where all this training and learning and experiences came to fruition, and you got to present the work that we see today. So we'll talk about your work and some of your projects.
Sure.
So let's begin with Inception.
Yeah.
Tell me about your childhood. Were you inclined towards the arts because you went on to study architecture and then dropped out? So was architecture your own pursuit, or was it by default because everyone was studying engineering and architecture?
For me, a lot of things just happen and I sort of just go with the flow, something will not fall into place, something will fall into place. So my father is in construction business and into property and a lot of that. So, but I really wanted to go and study business when I was, in my plus one and plus two. I was studying non-medical science and maths and all of those subjects. I knew that I don't want to study engineering, but I really didn't know what to do. So I actually dropped a year after my class 12th also, because just figuring out what to do, what to do. And I had applied to certain universities in New Zealand, and I had gotten through few, Victoria University I got through, Auckland University I got through. But it just it never sort of fulfills. I never ended up going there. So that entire year, I was just sitting home, figuring out kya karein. And then one of my classmates who had taken admission in architecture school in Chitkara, she was my best friend. And I called her and I was like, Tanveer, I don't know what to do. I think I'm getting depressed. Or, it's just that state of affairs. I'm not able to take any decision. I know what I don't want to do, but I really can't make up my mind.
Hmm.
She goes like, oh, why don't you come join architecture? It's pretty simple. You know, it's like fun and all. And I was like, okay, let me just figure out. And till then, I had like never sketched in my life. All my drawing assignments used to be done by my cousin sister, who was an amazing artist. So I was like, okay, let me just like, you know, look up kya hota hai, kaise hota hai. So I figured out there's a NATA examination that you have to appear for architecture.
Hmm.
There were certain things you need to do, like certain kind of drawings, shading and stuff. So I went to my cousin sister. I was like, Amandi, can you now teach me?
Hmm.
So she taught me a few basics. She gave me like few scenes, you know. So I went back home, sketched those, came back after like 2 days. And she's like, yeah, you've learned it, you know. So now you can just like go back and practice more. So I got into architecture like that because I was like, well, I have a friend in the same university and I wanted to get away from my home. So I think it was sort of an escape plan.
Okay.
But I think I was in third year when things back home started to fall like here and there, and my dad's business was crumbling. So I sort of took a break from college and went back home. And I was helping him with his business. And so there was this disconnect for about a year that I wasn't in the college. And fourth year, we have our internship. Mm-hmm. And so I went to intern with Gurmeet Rai, who's a conservation architect. And she's also married to Raghu Rai, the photographer.
Okay.
And what happened there was that Gurmeet and Raghu Rai, they shared their office space. So one section of the office will be sitting, like architects will be sitting and working, and one section of the space, Raghu Rai's team will be sitting and they'll be working on photos.
Hmm.
So I would finish my work and I would not leave for my home, but I will, you know, peep into his office, kya ho raha hai.
Hmm.
So at that time, the book called Trees that Raghu Rai came up with, I think in 2014 or 2015, that was being sort of finalized, you know. So I would see prints of like trees, basically the photos that he's taken, you know, like A1 size prints. He would sit with them, mark, you know, how he wants to edit. And I think that really got me sort of interested in image making. And I started taking photos when I was in architecture school, like the whole sense of aesthetic, the whole idea of looking at everything in like 2D, because you would have to draw and then imagine like how it will come in 3D, and process was just like reverse, right?
Yeah.
So all of that sort of started happening in architecture school. Few of my friends bought DSLRs and they got bored like within like first few months, and then I would, you know, I couldn't buy. So I asked my parents if I can, you know, buy a DSLR, and they were like, oh, we've sent you to become an architect, not become a photographer. So so I would request my friends to sort of send me their cameras so that I can like sort of play around, you know. And because I used to stay in hostel in the campus, so I would, you know, walk around in the evening, take photos of people, and people were also like sort of very friendly towards you, because they'll be like, oh, you don't know who this guy is. But I think by when I was in second year, so the like people who were like same batch or like older than you, they would have seen you around in hostel and they'd be like familiarized with you, so they would let me take their photos. So I think that's when my whole sort of like, you know, like the photo taking process started. And when I was at Gurmeet Rai's office, it just like grew stronger, because I saw Raghu Rai working and his work. Like I got introduced to his work then, and he's the only person whose work I have like followed majorly. And so when I went back from Gurmeet Rai's office after like 6 months of internship, and I was like very strong-headed about, you know, completing my architecture, becoming a conservation architect, and the kind of projects that I had worked in Gurmeet Rai's office also gave me a certain kind of confidence. And she also, like, she, I think after, because there was a whole 1 year gap of me being at college, so I was already in like double minds that maybe okay. I should just like leave it now because mm-hmm. it's just like two and a half or 3 years that I've spent. But she sort of like pushed me a lot, you know. She helped me understand how it's not just about building like or making buildings, you know. It's more like architecture is much more than that. So I went back with the intention of completing architecture and, you know, becoming a conservation architect later. But I think it's this sad state of affairs that we have in our colleges. There was like, when I went back, it was very sort of a different environment. All my questions were regarded as, oh, how would you know? You know, like you weren't here for an entire year. So that sort of put me off again. And I sort of started dreading going to the class. So my only, and when I was interning, so I saved up some money and I bought myself a camera. So my only sort of getaway in those times were, you know, going out and taking photos. So I would still be in hostel or in college, or I will go to my friend's place in Chandigarh and mm-hmm. I will take photos. And like wherever I went, I had camera on me. So yeah, so I think, by the end of fifth year, which was the last semester, 10th semester, and I still had few backs in terms of the exams that had failed in the previous years, and especially the third year when I was not there at all. The whole, like, I had about some 30, 36 exams that I was supposed to appear for. Mm-hmm. So I was clearing those in my ninth semester or, you know, eighth semester and seventh semester. But I couldn't clear much. But what was really shocking to me was when I went for my thesis program in the last semester, my college told me that they won't allow me to attempt my thesis. And they asked me to come back next year. And which was sort of their own sort of rule that they had made, you know, just to sort of get out more money from the students so that we end up wasting another year and then come back next year. And we still have to pay the fees for each semester, even if we are not there, right? So I think I wasn't just ready to give another year to architecture at that point of time. And I just like told them that I won't, you know, I will not continue. So I left, and I remember I'd gone to my principal and he said, oh, Vachche, we can't, you know, because you have a lot of backs and stuff. And they had started marking me absent while I was still in the class. So that really put me off. I think it was the system that they were following, and I was just not ready to be part of that system at that point of time. So I told them then, you know, I don't want your degree. And I just like walked off from his office. And then like 2 hours later, I realized, oh, fuck, what have I done? You know, what I'm going to tell my parents, what have I done?
You mentioned that you were already doing a lot of gigs and getting paid a lot. Then how did this idea come to you that you should go and train now? And how did you get to know about this institute, IIHS, in Bangalore?
So IIHS is not, so IIHS stands for Indian Institute for Human Settlements. And they do not train people for images or photography or anything of that sort. It's just like, it's a place where, so they're doing a lot of work, basically. They're working with governments, they're working with MNCs, they're working with different colleges across the globe. They're working with different universities. They offer a lot of courses. They, like, to a point, like, they also go and teach IAS and IPS officers when they are under training, right?
Okay.
So they started this program called Urban India Fellowship Program, which was bringing in people from diverse backgrounds together.
Mm-hmm.
And they can sit and talk and discuss and learn about how urban India functions. So there were economists, there were art historians, there were planners, architects, filmmakers, producers. There were a whole lot bunch of people, everybody other than medical background, basically, you know. And I was there, I don't know, like, technically I was just like 12th pass, you know. But we had like different sort of labs. Like, we had a filmmaking lab also there. We had a GIS lab as well. We had like a whole sort of 3-4 weeks course on identity and social practice, same with governance, same with economy, same with ecology. We were looking at water from a very different perspective. We were looking at, so it was just like bringing everybody together and looking at a problem and trying to solve it from different perspectives, you know, rather than just an engineer coming in and only looking at from very engineerical sort of way, or somebody who's a sociologist who will come in and only look at it from like a very socio-political angle. So they brought in everybody together, and then we started working in groups, you know, like a group of 10 people will work on one thing, or a group of 2 people will work on one thing, or like 4 or 6 people will work on one thing and come up with like these crazy solutions which we like, or they would have never imagined. So it was very, so for example, like there was this one girl who studied sociology all her life, and when she was presenting her solutions to the problems, she ended up making like a whole like, you know, model to present the solution, which she also was like, I never knew that I can make models, you know. So for me, it wasn't, IHS wasn't a place much to learn in terms of image or photography, but more to learn about what's happening in the country, what's happening in the world, what are the issues at hand, what is the politics of everything. And I think that sort of changed my like perception of life also.
With that, we can move on to the second section, assembly line. I'm going to talk a bit more about your learnings at IIHS.
Yeah.
So since you said you learned a lot about life, can you tell us, share with us some of the movies that you watched maybe, or the books that you read, which really shaped your perspectives there?
I think one of the films that we watched there was Kamati Padam, that Rajiv Ravi had made. It's a Malayalam film. And Rajiv Ravi was there when we watched that film. I mean, we had watched it as a part of our course, but then they also had this film festival that they do, and the writing festival that they do. So Rajiv Ravi had come again with his film for the film festival. And because we had studied identity and social practice, and we had studied governance, and we really, really didn't like read entire books there because the time frame was very small. Like we were only there for about 7 months.
Okay.
And for 2 months, we had to go out and intern wherever we feel like interning, right? You know, like we read Ambedkar there, we read, I mean, I won't even remember half of the people, but we ended up reading a lot of laws. So we were reading about ecology. So we had these immersion trips there where, like, once we went to Madurai, and we had this meeting with the DC of Madurai, and we were supposed to do like entire research of what Madurai is, what was the history, what's happening right now, what are the problems Madurai is facing, what is the socio-political condition there. It's a temple town, right? So like if I tell anybody about Madurai, people will be like, oh, you're not gonna go to this temple and come back. Also, Madurai is becoming this smart city now. You know, it's like part of the smart city project. So we were reading about that as well. And strangely, we came across this news item which said that Madurai is only left with for about 7 days of drinking water. And we were like, how is that possible? You know, like, how can a city only have 7 days of drinking water? So we brought this question to the DC, and he said, oh, it's not a problem. You know, we're fixing it. We are doing like bore wells outside the city. We have already commissioned some 500 bore wells, or maybe like 1,000 bore wells. We'll have enough water. And if we need, we'll get the water from the sea. And we're just like sitting there and figuring out, what are you talking? You are the district commissioner, and you are talking about bore wells so casually, you know, as if there's like unlimited water under us. And you're talking about bringing water from the sea. Like, look at where Madurai is situated and look how far the sea is. And desalinization plants cost so much. And then transporting water will will be like whole another sort of, you know, problem in itself. And so it's like we started to understand, like even personally, I started to understand that, you know, lot of things, lot of laws that are being made, lot of the way also the administration is also working, mm-hmm. is not pro people. It's all about, you know, taking care of certain section of the society. Like we went to this one resettlement colony in Madurai, which was this, basically there was this slum within the city limits, which was resettled some 35, 40 kilometers outside the city. There's no proper road there. There are only these buildings which have come up, or the small little houses that have come up. There are no roads there. There's no sewage system there. But people overnight were, you know, moved into buses and they were transported there. So you started looking at, you know, like, now when I go to the set, I see, for me, a spot dada is not just a spot dada. I like, you know, I look beyond. I see, like, I don't know where he lives. I don't know where he comes from. I want to know where he comes from. I want to know where the light man lives. Has he been living in Bombay all his life, or has he, you know, has he like moved from different states for the work? For me, assistant directors are not just aspiring filmmakers. I look at what state they come from, you know, what are their social political views? What do they think of, you know, the culture of A crew, B crew, C crew when we are eating food, right? Like, I remember when I went on Manmarzia, you know, there was, I almost walked into this eating space and another, like, another assistant director pulled me out. It was my first day. And he said, no, our food is there. Oh. And I'm like, what do you mean by our food, right? So I see, like, this, it said B crew food, and it had, like, the steel thalis, and people were, like, they only had, like, 3-4 different options to eat from. And then there was crew A food, right? A crew food, and it had, like, wholesome, like, 10 things to choose from to eat, right? So, I mean, a lot of these things, so even when I'm photographing on set, and I try to capture these things in my photos, you know, like, though we don't see them regularly, and it, that's something also like my bigger project, you know, apart from what I'm shooting for the producers or for the film, I think it becomes really important for you to be a little sensitive about everything from, you know, like, from like as basic as eating food, you know, from the kind of hotel that you'll be put in, to the what car you are being driven to on set, you know, how many people will there be in that car. So I think all of this sensitivity wouldn't have come to me if I wouldn't have been at IHS. So I think that's one of the major learnings that I have.
That's very wonderfully put. Since you look at photography from a storytelling point of view, does it happen to you more that you try to figure out the story first of a frame and then click it, or you follow your instincts and click the pictures then try to make some sense out of it? What happens more? Yeah,
for me it's different every time. Sometimes it'll be the first, sometimes it'll be the letter, you know. So for example, when I'm on film set, I have a very specific instruction from the producers, like one of which is I have to make sure that I have the same frames that DOP is shooting in terms of photos, you know. So then I really don't have much creative liberty to do anything.
Okay.
So then it's just like sort of ticking the boxes, you know, like I've got this shot and I've got this shot and I've got this shot. Apart from that, there's I think mostly it's very intuitive, because I'll see something and I'll quickly grab it, you know, and then and that's like the very this like millisecond sort of a moment that you have, and I would have thought something at that point of time. I would have taken a photo in a very whole different setting, in my head. And when I'll visit that photo that evening, I'll probably be very dissociated with the same photo. You know, I'll be like, I don't know why I shot this. You know, but I might revisit that photo after like 2 years or a year, like what I'm doing right now. And I'm like, dude, this is something. I don't know why this has never been put out. You know, so for me, it's never like either this or that. Okay. For me, it's as long as I'm getting to tell something, you know, some kind of story. This is another wonderful photographer that I really admire, Bandeep Singh. So I was watching one of his interviews or sort of thing, something where he talks about, you know, that for him, a photograph is that one moment mm-hmm. which only he has seen and he has captured it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, after like, let's say 10 years of that moment has passed, and if he'll put that moment back into that same time, the time will flow, you know, seamlessly.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, and that is like another thing that has sort of stayed with me, that, and then like Raghu Rai also talks about, you know, like for him, it's very spiritual thing, you know, like it's very mm-hmm. like he sees thing and suddenly something will happen and he'll take a shot and he'll be in awe of it
mm-hmm.
that, oh, I don't know what I've shot, you know, like I don't know how it got created. So for me, it's also like I'm also sort of still trying to figure out my visual language, honestly. But one thing that I really look forward is to tell the truth of what I'm taking yeah. the picture of, mm-hmm. you know. So it's not like what I want to convey, but it's more of what I'm shooting. It's their truth. It's never like my truth. So it can be perceived however it wants to be perceived. But for me, what's okay. more important is, you know, what the other person is trying to tell me.
With that, we can move on to the third section called Harvest, and we are going to talk about your work now.
Okay.
So I have seen that you have put pictures of the reading session of Chapak, and those pictures were also in the news. So can you tell us at what stage of the filmmaking process do you get involved?
It depends from producers. Like from producer to producer or director to director, you know, and it a lot actually depends on the marketing people.
Mm-hmm.
At what time do they want a photographer on board? So mostly it's the first day of shoot.
Okay.
When I'll actually go on set and meet people. But with Chapak, it was different because I got involved, I got on board way before they started doing their makeup trials or their costume mm-hmm. trials, you know. So I will be at the office reading the script, and then I'll go back every time they're having costume trials or makeup trials to photograph that. And then like, so with Chapak, it was very different. With other films, it's mostly, you get involved either the first day of shoot or if, for example, with Freedom, Debakar wanted us to be on the set for a rehearsal also, you know. So it's again like it's very director producer oriented approach, which made, and a lot of like marketing people also, like they decide mm-hmm. when a photographer comes on board.
Mm-hmm.
With a lot of films, I'll be there from day one of shoot to day last of shoot. With some films, I'll only be there whenever the marketing team wants me to be on the shoot, because they'll go through the schedule. They'll see, oh, these are the days that we want you to go and photograph. And that's about it.
Okay. So it's
different with every project, yeah.
Is it very difficult to shoot on a film set because so many people are working, there are so many equipments around you, lights and all, reflectors, and the DP is trying to capture a shot. So does it become difficult for you to get your shot right?
I think first few days are a little difficult because especially when you're going on set on the day one and you've not met the team before. So because it's like, you know, like assistant directors have been introduced to each other months ago. Cinematographer and the camera team know each other from like days ago because they all have come together, they've worked on light selection, they've done like a test shoot maybe on camera, they've looked at the camera, they've looked at the lights, production designers have been working since like few months, and the entire team with every basically department. All departments have been working on the film since long, and if you go and you're usually the alone, you know, like a photographer, sometimes you'll have a behind the scenes guy also doing stuff with you, but they are also sometimes involved way before the shoot actually begins, because people want to sort of document the costume process, the, you know, all of that. So it becomes difficult only in terms of sort of getting to know each other. But I think it's like you have to put your foot down at times when you tell them, you know, like, it's part of my job and I'm also here to take photos. So you sort of work around with first AD, and people know, right? Like now that, especially like I think past 4 or 5 years since still photographers have been being recognized also on film set. So people know that, oh, they also are here to do a job. And now nowadays what has happened is that the marketing team or the producers, somebody will be there on day one to sort of introduce you to everybody. But also it's like, you know, there are times when you sort of gauge the environment, you know, like, or either like we are running late, the shoot is running late, or like everything is in chaos and you don't want to add to that chaos.
Do you think that your job might start at an earlier stage with time, like going for recce with the directors or shooting the writer's room when the script is...
I really want to do that. Yeah. I keep telling some of the directors who I'm friends with, like Anurag, can I like come early and shoot? But it's again like either... So what happens is when they are writing or something of that sort is happening, either I am on some other shoot, you know, okay, so I'm not able to go and do that. Or it's something or the other. Like I have not been able to till now, you know, been able to document the film from its inception to completion. Like I really want to do something from like, you know, and I think I can only do it with some of my friends, because there's also a lot of trust factor, I believe. Ooh, not everybody trusts you from that initial stage. So like I would want to sort of go and photograph some people very early on and like shoot it till, you know, when it's in the post and, you know, and like sound is being done, foley is being done, all of that. Mm-hmm. That will be like my dream project actually.
How do you figure out which shot should be the first look or the poster?
I don't.
Okay.
It's all marketing. It's all marketing team. But what I do is I do sometimes send in my favorites.
Okay. Okay.
You know, like recently, if you've seen Class of 83, all the like the posters that are coming out and whatever thumbnail that they have on Netflix, they're probably being held by like 6-7 policemen.
Yeah.
So these are the photos that I've shared with the Netflix team when I was shooting them, or I've shown it to the director, like I really like this or something like that. So they also sort of take note, and we like sort of... So I tell them that these are my favorites, but end of the day, it's all like how marketing team decides to market the film. Yeah.
So I've gone through so many pictures in your profile. We'll discuss some of your pictures, both the story behind clicking that picture and the story it is telling. We'll try to discuss those. I'm going to share my screen so that you can see the pictures. Could you tell us the story behind these two pictures? There's Abhishek Bachchan against the glass window and Vicky and Tapsee.
So, you know, this one was taken before. Vicky and Tapsee's photo was taken before. So there was this one lane where the house that we've shot the entire film in Amritsar, right? And we've shot it in like the walled city of Amritsar. There was this one lane near the house that we were shooting, which had this amazing light beam, like sunlight that would come every day. Like this used to be the time when around evening at around, I think 4:15 or 4:30 when sun would cross. And usually I would be like either going to have some tea or snacks at that time of the day, you know. And I saw it for 2 days every day. And then I went to Tapsee and Vicky and I was like, dude, like we really need to make these photos. You know, if tomorrow you guys are free at around 4:15, 4:30, can you just like step out? And we like quickly do like 5 minute shoot. And they were like very happy. They were like, yeah, like we'll do. And the next day they were shooting a scene, like a proper scene. And then after the scene got over and I was like, yeah, I was like really like scared to ask. Also because it was my first film, right? So, and they had like done some heavy scene also. And Vicky only came to me. Vicky's like, oh, chal photo khichiye chal ke. And I got like really happy. So we went and they were like, so what should we do? I was like, I don't know, just like do something like what lovers do, you know. So like maybe you can like walk and stuff. So Vicky was walking and Tapsee just like ran and jumped on him. And they just like walked. I like took some like 15 shots there. And then there was another. So then the light, because light changes very drastic. Like you have like 5-6 minutes of this window. And then light went on the other side. And one of those photos have made it to the album art. Of one of the songs when the songs were being released every day. So we shot like few photos there and yeah, that's it. Like that's how that was shot. With the Abhishek one, this was when we were shooting this scene where Abhishek and Tapsee leave for their honeymoon. So, and it started raining like crazily. And so Abhishek, so everybody was basically inside. You can like, you can't figure it out, but there's a manager who's standing right behind Abhishek and they're like makeup people standing there.
Okay.
But like two out of focus, it really doesn't matter. Right? So, and right outside the hotel, so outside the glass, there was this sort of a plinth, like a, like this much of a space, you know, like you can put your 1 foot on it. And it was under the shade also. So I wasn't getting wet there, but I could easily stand there. So Abhishek came and stood near the glass just to see what's happening. You know, like, what is the delay? Why has he been called early? So, or like, probably we had done some shots and it started raining. So he was just like figuring out, kya kare, kab kare.
So that was the shot.
Yeah.
And I'm imagining about the shot. Okay. Yeah.
So I was just standing there, I was like, oh, this looks really nice, let me just take some photos, you know. And I never knew that this is going to make to like...
Yeah, oh, thing that is,
So yeah, it's like, I think some of the images have like very basic stories also and they just turn out.
It looks so serious, bahut andar chala gaya character mein. But it's just basically waiting for the shot, okay.
Yeah, he's just like, let's do it, guys, what is like, why are the clouds here?
Yeah. Let's move on to the next one. I'm going to share again. So this one is from the screening of Chapak.
Yes.
Gulzar Saab and Meghna Gulzar. So I have questions. Why low angle? Why black and white? And is this low shutter speed photography? Because effect aisa dikh raha hai. Is it? I don't know. I'm very technically challenged in terms of this department.
It's shot on iPhone.
Okay.
It says also shot on iPhone.
It's
right after the crew cast and crew screening that happened. And Gulzar Saab was seated in the row right behind me. And Meghna was sitting, I think, some 6 rows in front of me. So as soon as the film ended and everybody sort of got up and everybody was clapping, and Meghna's first reaction was to come back and hug Gulzar Saab. And I just like went around and like shot like without even like looking, you know. I know like she's, because I don't know, I could sense like she's gonna come and hug or whatever. So I just like moved around like this and I like took like some 5-6 images and super low light, you know, like how when the film ends they're only like in PVR those yellow lights which come up with a hint of red.
Yeah.
So with color, it looked really like all over the place. But then when I was treating it, I sort of felt like this like black and white sort of goes goes with it. And then this motion, and there was this whole commotion happening in the theater. People were like really emotional at that time, you know. Meghna especially was really emotional. And for me also, I think I had never spent this kind of time with any other film, like from pre-production to sort of, you know, finishing it till the last day of shoot. And then we had like in breaks also in between. So we would like come back, then go back to shoot again, then come back again, go back to shoot again. So it was like, it was just like 44 days of shoot, but it sort of was spanned over about 60, 65 days. So there was, I think the hall had like some crazy emotions at that time, the cast and the crew. And I think that picture just defines everything of the release for me. Yeah.
Does the low angle mean that we try to show them in a bigger light? Like,
no, it really doesn't. So also, I think it would have been, I didn't want it to make it very obvious that I am taking this picture.
Mm-hmm.
So because Gulzarsa was right behind me on the seat. And I didn't want it to like, you know, go like this and take a photo because it would have been like really awkward.
Yeah.
It's a sly photo. Like it's a very sly photo. Like, I showed it to Meghna right after I shot it and like quickly edited it. And I showed it to her and she also asked for it. She like sent it to me. I really like this picture.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted it to be as, you know, like me taking a photo of them should not be the act at that point. You know, it was purely what was happening between a father and a daughter and a filmmaker and like an aged filmmaker who's like
veteran.
Yeah, you know. And Gulzarsa wrote lyrics also for the film, right? So so it was like, I think it was also another moment because one of the days Gulzarsa had come on set. And we were like just excited.
Nice.
Like Gulzarsa is coming on set. You know? So I have like some pictures of your like the Pranav, who was this on set sound recordist, he was asked to give Gulzarsa, you know, headphones. So just like him handing over those headphones to Gulzarsa. And then Gulzarsa was sitting next to the script supervisor, looking at what was being shot. And then just like how she was sort of reacting to his presence, you know. And for me also, it's like I have like read some of his poems. I've watched some of his, you know, like watched some of the films which had his lyrics. Probably would have watched his films also. And he has this whole persona, right? Like only wear white kurta pajama and like he'll walk also very like peacefully. Yeah, so I think it was just like sort of extension to that for me, you know. So maybe like you can say it like it's like showing them sort of bigger because
kind of showing the celebration.
Okay. Yeah, maybe. Like for me it's very like, you know, you see the hand of Gulzarsa on Meghna's head also.
Yeah.
You know, so I think for me it's like very sort of care and love.
Move on to the fourth one.
Yeah.
Yes. This picture of Tapsi.
Yeah.
So my interpretation is like kind of she is like disconnected. That's what you were trying to portray maybe. And she's away in her own, something like that. What's the story behind this picture?
Yeah, so you know, this is also I think one of the few times when so I've shot a lot with Tapsi, like from film sets to promotions to just like hanging around with her, like fooling around and just like taking pictures. So this, and because on film set, because of my relation that I have been around her and she's my friend now, I have this sort of, I think, I don't know if like I can go to her van as soon as I'm on set, even if she's getting ready, right? Or she's getting her makeup done and make some photos. So over the time, I've realized that when she's get like when her hair are being done, when she's getting her makeup done, it's like she's in a very different world. She'll have certain kind of music being played, you know, and she's like lost in thoughts. And sometimes she'll always like she'll be on calls also, like telling things to people or discussing certain things. This one we shot in Chennai and we were promoting Game Over at that time.
Acha.
And I think it was like very busy. Like we were in Chennai for a day, then we came to Delhi for a day and then went back to Chennai. Then we were supposed to go to Hyderabad. So every day we were taking flights in the morning, reaching, shooting, like giving interviews and stuff. And then she would have like few changes. And this is one of the first set of image that I shot, and I've shot it from like, I had kept a glass in front of me and then I've shot it.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's also sort of
shows like, another aspect of Tapsee.
Yeah. Like me creating, you know, that barrier also. In,
how wonderful you put, nice.
You know, that I don't want to like to get close. And also like the till early, like till late last year, I've only shot on 85mm lens. I've not shot on any other lens. I've from Thappar is when I've started shooting on 50mm. So 85 give me a like a nice good distance also. You know, so I would like keep a distance, take some photos, and those, and I think that shows also like it's there's a certain kind of closeness to it and there's a certain kind of like distance to it. So because 85 gave me like, you know, even like if you're in a room and I'm still shooting, I'll be like super close to you in terms of my photo. But if I add some sort of barriers that I want to portray, so like I think glass sort of comes a nice, very interesting, because another friend of mine who's moving to Bombay. So I wanted to gift her something and I asked her, what do you want? She's like, give me a print of your photo. I was like, you choose. So she's chosen this photo. She's like, I really like this photo. Which reminds me, like, I have to now get it printed and framed also.
Like, we have reached to the end of this conversation. And thank you so much for being with us for so long. And this department was very, very unknown to me. Like, I got to learn a lot. And I'm sure the people watching us have learned a lot about film photography and also the profession of being a photo artist.
And
thank you so much for doing so. And all the best with all your projects. And
thank
hope
you.
That you get to shoot a film right from the inception to the end.
I hope. I think I'll bully one of my director friends to let me do that. But yeah, I hope I do that. Yes. Thank you so much.
It was great fun talking to you. All the best and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You too.
Hey guys, if you like that video, do share it with your friends and family. Do not forget to subscribe to the Red Sparrow for educative and entertaining content, and make sure you press the bell icon.